The line between success and failure, as we all know, is razor thin.
The human immune system is a complex fortress that fights off foreign invaders, such as viruses, by creating antibodies. However, in an estimated 4% of the world's population, the body is in a constant state of battle with itself, producing antibodies that attack a person's own healthy tissues. The result can be debilitating autoimmune disease. Today, companies across the biopharmaceutical industry are developing innovative therapies that address a host of autoimmune conditions. One standout is Argenx, which CEO Tim Van Hauwermeiren and his co-founders started in 2008. Their goal? Address the source of autoimmunity rather than merely treat the symptoms. As an analyst covering biotech companies at Morgan Stanley Research, I was eager to learn more about Tim, his entrepreneurial journey, and his ideas for keeping innovation front and center.
Tim, thanks for joining us. Really appreciate your time. I wanted to start by learning a bit about your journey prior to Argenx, the entrepreneurial path that led you to co-founding the company.
Actually, I didn't start my career in this industry. I started my career in fast-moving consumer goods. And when I look back at my own career, I think I have always made choices where I gravitated towards entrepreneurs. And then when I took my first job in P&G, I took it because I wanted to be close to these guys who build real new products. I wanted to be in biotech, and I joined another biotech company, a startup, and I wanted to be as close as I could to that entrepreneur. I would have taken any job he offered me. So he offered me a job in business development, and he also exposed me to the financing deals, the IPO, so the learning curve was very steep. And then at a given point in time, you realize you just want to do it yourself, right? You want to start and build your own company.
What was the specific spark of inspiration that led you and your co-founders to chart a path of entrepreneurship in drug development?
And I knew I wanted to start my own company. That's also why I went to do an executive MBA. I just wanted to be ready, and I was waiting for the opportunity to knock on the door. And then my two other co-founders, they were walking around with a pretty cool idea to break into fully human antibodies, but they didn't know what to do with it. So at a given point in time, all these things just get together and you decide to jump. And that's what we decided. And we didn't think long. You know, we resigned from our jobs, we incorporated the company, and the rest is history.
What did you have at that moment? What did the pipeline look like? What sort of funding did you have?
Vikram, we had nothing. The only thing I had were my two co-founders. And frankly speaking, I didn't care too much where it all would start. I had confidence in the fact that if I could work with these two guys, we would make something exciting.
So what was the elevator pitch to investors at that time?
If you go back to 2008, that's when we founded the company, it was extremely difficult to get money for a startup company. But my co-founders had a really cool idea to break into that fully human antibody space in a totally different way. And that was the pitch. Eli Lilly, they had seen some of our very initial data from the platform, and they were struck by the diversity of these antibody panels we could create. So we entered into a small pilot program with them to validate the technology. And they just wanted one antibody cracking a specific epitope on a target of interest. And they gave us 2 years' time to get there. Well, in 6 months' time, we gave them 12. So the business model in the beginning was cracking someone else's difficult targets with our platform. Then it evolved. You know, we started to attract investors. And they really liked the products which we were building. And they thought, we should not just do this as a service for other people. We should actually start to develop these molecules. And that's what we started to do. Finding a drug which works really well is a rare event in our industry. So in order to really create shareholder value, you need to find a way to hang on to that asset as long as you can. So they really encouraged us to walk down the path up to approval and product launch.
How have you honed your process of filtering out useful advice from input that may not be in the best interest of moving the pipeline forward?
Advice I always give to younger entrepreneurs is surround yourself with your own personal advisory boards. And what you need is people who have been in exactly the same place as where you are and with whom you can have a very open and a very frank conversation. So I had a number of CEOs, biotech CEOs in my personal advisory board, and by just comparing and contrasting their views, their experience, you start to see a pattern in the feedback. And the pattern is something you have to believe.
Were there ever times at the early phase of the company where you felt like Argenx may not make it?
Oh, there were quite a few near-death experiences, as we call them. You look, raising money in 2008, 2009 was nearly impossible. We were extremely close to going out of business by the time we did the Series A financing round. And you learn how to survive in days where you have no cash. And that was one of the surprises we had in the beginning. The network we could fall back on and people who were genuinely interested to help, that was impressive. I remember 2016, 17, we were almost out of money. Did again, you know, a lot of non-deal roadshows with zero results, and was ready to take the plane back home and ready to go into shutdown modus with the company, where I got an invitation from an investor for dinner. And the last thing I wanted to do was to have dinner with an investor, you know. I wanted to go home. But at the end of the dinner, he asked me whether it would be possible to take 10% in the company. Look, if I would have taken the plane back home, maybe there would have been no Argenx. In hindsight, people always construct fantastic strategies and great stories. There's a good portion of luck involved, and the line between success and failure, as we all know, is razor thin.
How did you maintain conviction to keep pushing forward despite obstacles that may just seem insurmountable at that moment?
We happen to be a complementary team. And that's a very important thing. The ability to just fall back on each other when there's a difficult time and stand shoulder to shoulder, I think that's a very important factor. Also, these initial moments are foundational to the culture of the company. When times are tough, when you have nothing, and you completely depend on the goodwill of other people, you learn to be humble. Humility is still one of the core pillars of our culture. The other realization is that data drives everything in this sector. I mean, you can make any pitch you like, but data will drive your future.
Drug pricing has been a big topic of discussion.
The real debate should indeed not be around the price, but around the value you offer. I think your value equation, your value proposition needs to be very carefully thought through from the get-go. But it's about being able to articulate the long-term value of the product through the lens of society. It also means that when you innovate, you need to put the bar very high. I mean, what is the value society will be willing to pay for 5, 10, 15 years down the road? The days are over that you can just come out of the gate with a price and just hope people will pick it.
As you've transitioned from an early stage biotech to a company with a commercialized product, a growing pipeline, how do you maintain that spirit of innovation?
We don't think that innovation is restricted to just people in white coats at the bench. Everyone can innovate. And we celebrate examples of innovation, not just in the new molecules which we build. I think the clinical trial designs of Argenx are pretty innovative. I think the way we interact with patients is pretty innovative. But also the way we, for example, interact with payers is innovative.
Clinical setbacks are part and parcel of drug development. How do you handle those situations?
The mindset of an innovator, a pioneer, has to be that you will run into the unexpected. So optionality is key. That's your best protection against the unknown unknown. You have multiple horses in the race, and may the best horse win based on the data. There are no good data or bad data, there are data. And they tell you where to go, where to allocate your resources, and where you double down and where you should stop.
Biotech can be highly competitive. How do you maintain your edge?
So I think once you have this novel, interesting target, and you start to de-risk it, you know competition will follow. So we spend a lot of time making sure that when we build an antibody molecule, it's also probably a best-in-class molecule. Competition will be very hard-pressed to improve over it.
What do you think the future of Argenx looks like?
I think an important or an interesting lens to look through when you try to answer that question is, and I invite every entrepreneur to think about it, who would miss you when you would not exist? I think that's a key question. What I know for a fact is that MG patients will miss us. CIDP patients will miss us. MMN patients will miss us. And many, many more patients will miss us. I'm convinced they will remember the year in which they were dosed with one of our products. And then last but not least, we have to reflect on what is the value we bring to society. If we really try to pioneer autoimmunity, well, we need to further the science. We need to further the understanding of the biology and make sure we continue to innovate, you know, out of that understanding and not stay with a few commercial successes.
Tim, thank you so much for joining us. Sincerely appreciate your time.
Thanks for having us. I enjoyed it.